I decided that dice towers would make a fun holiday exchange gift, so I'm going to use some of this red oak to make a few. This board is almost 8 inches wide, so I need to rip a bit off of one edge to be able to flatten it on my 6-inch jointer. With two sides jointed, I'll run it through the planer to make the other side flat and parallel. The boards are now about 3/4 of an inch thick, but I want something closer to 1/4 inch, so I'll resaw them. After smoothing out the inside of that cut, I can rip them to final width. I'm going to get 3 towers out of these 2 thin boards, but before I break it down further, I'll tape them back together exactly how they were before resawing. This will allow me to match the grain on the corners. Now I'll start the joinery for the first box. First I'll cut one piece into the side and front, then cut the other piece into the other side and the back. This tower joinery will be box joints, or finger joints as some call them, so I need to change out my alternating bevel crosscut blade for a flat top rip blade. I still haven't replaced my dado blade, so I'll cut this with my rip blade using the method I documented in my last woodworking video. A link to that video should be up in the corner now. The final step for this tower is to cut the front face in two. The lower end will be open for the dice to come out. I'll glue the cutoff in place, then cut it out again later, as a simple way to fill in the extra box joint slots. But before doing that, I'll cut the parts for the other two towers. These are going to be mitered corners, so I'll begin by putting a 45-degree edge on either side. Then I'll move to the bandsaw to cut the sides from the front and back. This saw cuts a smaller kerf, so the grain won't be as disrupted. Then it's back to the table saw to put 45-degree miters on those new edges. Here you can begin to see the intended effect, with the grain pattern wrapping continuously around the corner. The front panel needs the same sort of opening cut off as the box chart tower. I want the dice to tumble side to side before being ejected out the front. So I'll plan to install some ramps to bounce the dice around. The side to side ramps will sit at 30 degrees off horizontal.
This way, so that
the bottom ramp will sit at 45 degrees. The ramps will be made of more 1/4-inch red oak. I had to make the 30-degree ramp cut on the bandsaw, which left a rougher edge than I wanted, so I'll quickly plane it smooth. The ramps are primarily held in place by dados in the walls of the tower. I made this quick jig that I can set exactly on the mark I scribed a moment ago, and then run my trim router along it to cut each dado. The router left a round end at the end of the dado, so I've sharpened a chisel to quickly square it off.
I think I can just pull the front off.
Now you can see the ramps in place. The dice bounce left off the first, dropping onto the second and heading back to the right, where they finally drop onto the third and are kicked out the front. It's just about time to glue these up, so first I'll sand the internal components and tower walls. Yes, I like to spread glue on each finger joint individually. It makes for less cleanup later. These joints were tight, so a little percussive persuasion was necessary. In addition to the dados, I'll also add some glue to the beveled face to hold the ramps tight to the wall. Once I've gotten it all seated, I'll clamp it all tightly to make sure none of those fingers get squeezed out while the glue sets. On to the mitered boxes. There's the continuous grain we'll see wrapped around the outside. By taping the outside edges of these panels together, I'll be able to essentially roll the tower together after I've put glue on the miters. The trickiest part of this glue-up is getting those ramps into the dados on the opposite face. The bottom piece on the front is not glued in on these, but taping it in place during glue-up helps keep the rest of the sides aligned. The bottom shelf can be slid into its dados from the outside after assembly. Mitre Tower 2 went just as smoothly. After the glue dried, I planed the top and bottom flush. These miters won't be strong enough for years of gameplay with just glue holding them together, so I'm going to add some splines across them. Four around the middle, four around the top, and two on the lower back corners. The first tower will have splines made from the same 1/4-inch red oak as the rest of the box. Cutting these slots used a technique very similar to my box joint technique, where I used a piece of spline as a gauge, then readjusted the stop block using a spacer matching my blade's kerf to get an exact fit. Indeed, that fit is perfect. I glue them into place by spreading glue into the slot and a bit on the spline, and then sliding the spline in. My biggest mistake here was using offcuts of the ramp material. That 30-degree bevel was sharp and very unpleasant to push on. For the second tower, I wanted to try something new. The contraption mounted in the bottom of the spline jig causes the slot to be cut at a 30-degree angle. I'll use splines that fit a single kerf on this one to avoid the process getting too out of hand. I could have tilted my blade to 30 degrees instead, but I make a lot of picture frames using this jig, and I didn't want to risk ruining the zero clearance 90 degree slot. To show off that slanted spline, I'm going to use a contrasting dark walnut. Once the glue is dried, I can cut off the excess spline material. This fine-tooth pull saw made this a breeze. I left this tape on while adding the splines to give the miters some extra support. It worked. The miters didn't break, but it was a pain to remove afterward. The tape also kept the saw above the surface of the tower, so some planing was also necessary. Finally, time to remove the box joint tower's lower front panel. I started with a router and a narrow bit. When the panel started to vibrate as it became less attached, I pulled out a fine dovetail saw to finish the cut. I used a chisel to flush up the remaining panel material to the tower wall. I used 80 grit sandpaper to flush the exposed ends of the box joints to the walls. The other two boxes also had a few tool marks to remove. Finally, on to finish prep. 150 grit sandpaper to remove the marks from the 80 grit, then 220 grit to remove the marks from the 150 grit. I am really happy with how these cleaned up. I've chosen a water-based polyurethane finish for these towers. It should hold up well to gameplay environments. Just watch that end grain pop on those box joints. While these towers can be used on an open table, it's also nice to have a tray that will catch the dice, so I built three off-camera. I want the back high, but the front needs to be lower to ease access to the dice, so I'll cut a curve out to lower it.
Like that. Use that line, and then that meets that point. And then we'll just... So, what do we think of it?
That's better.
And then it closed up.
I'm going to line the inside of the tray, so I prepared a template to help me cut some felt. The felt will both soften the final bounce of the dice and also fill the empty space between the tower and the tray to make it a nice snug fit. The best method I found for attaching the felt was to spread a thin layer of wood glue on the wood surface only, and then simply press and clamp the felt onto it. The felt seemed well adhered, and yet the exposed side stayed soft because none of the glue bled through. Once the glue had set, I trimmed the felt flush with the top of the tray. Test fit, test roll. It works! And it is mesmerizing to just sit there and keep rolling dice. Here's the reason for the high back of the tray. It covers the top of the tower, so when inserted this way, the dice stay captured inside. Okay, you've waited long enough. How about some glamour shots? The green wrapping is very subtle on the box joint tower, but I love the way the checkered opening mimics the shape of the dice. The thick oak splines almost disappear into the grain wrapping, but then pop out of nowhere when the light catches them right. The slanted, contrasting splines almost pull too much interest away from the grain wrap, but I love the way they turned out.